Welcome, MS Translators. It's my pleasure to be here tonight for another Facebook Live video, being joined by Andrew and Sarah on location tonight from Pilates on Bourke. And we're going to be talking a little bit about how Pilates can be used to help manage your multiple sclerosis. So as with all our Facebook Live videos, make sure that if you have questions, we're going to be answering your questions live as we go along. So just submit them in the comments box below, and we'll be answering them as we go through. Also, so as many people can see this as possible, we do ask, make sure that you like it, you share the post as we go on, so that as many people can tune in and watch this as we're broadcasting. So it's not about me tonight, as opposed to all of our other Facebook Live videos where you have to listen to me rabbit on. It's about these guys tonight, so I'm going to throw over to you guys to introduce yourselves. And maybe Andrew, you might want to start by just telling us a little bit about why you started doing Pilates in the first place.
Sure, okay. All right, well, introductions first. I'm Andrew Scott. I've had diagnosed MS since the early 1990s. And when you've had it for that long, it doesn't start as a particularly severe case. It gets worse as you go along. You have to learn to adapt to it. It morphs into something a little different as you're going along, and I use Pilates to help manage that change and try and get back to the most normal way of operating that I possibly can. I first started out doing Pilates without any real understanding of what it was, but once I began, I thought it was the best form of exercise for the problems that I had, which were all about tightness and difficulty moving. And it was then that I realised that I wasn't just a person with MS, I was like lots of other people of my own age who simply couldn't do the things that they thought they should be able to do. So it's not limited just to having MS, but having MS, this Pilates method actually helps you get more normal movement, more normal motion through your whole body. So that's why I've kept doing it now for the better part of 15 years. And the best part of that's probably been the last 6 years when Sarah's been looking after me, because she's done it at a much better level as we've been going along, and that's helped a great deal as well.
Firstly, I'm Sarah. I'm Andrew's Pilates instructor and owner here at Pilates on Bourke. I think Andrew was being far too kind to me about it got better in the last 6 years, but I can't take all the credit. So I'm a Pilates instructor. I work with a variety of individuals, ranging from a very fit elite athlete, ranging right through to the elderly, through to individuals with cerebral palsy that may be wheelchair bound. And what I love about the Pilates method is the equipment that we have in a studio, which we'll get to show you later on, I believe.
We will.
Is that it can cater to many different individual needs. The equipment is designed to assist and facilitate movement and to teach movement, regardless of individuals' abilities or strengths or limitations. And as the body learns to move, the equipment then can challenge that movement and progress. The other thing I hope that we'll be able to show you tonight, and what I love about the Pilates method, is it may be a set of X amount of exercises, and there are hundreds and hundreds to choose from, but every single one of them can be tailor-made for the body that we're teaching in front of us. So it's a really personal type of training. It's a very supportive environment in terms of the equipment and the instructors. And I also think you might support this, I hope, in the other individuals you meet in a studio. It's very supportive from a friendship level, an exercise level, motivation level. And I hope that eventually many of you will get to experience that.
Fantastic. And I think just for people who are watching that at home, if it wasn't clear, Sarah wasn't pointing at me when she said, extremely fit elite athletes. It kind of looked like you were, but no, it's not me. So an important point that Sarah did just bring up as well, we're going to do this as two separate Facebook Live videos. So we're going to do the Q&A to start with. for roughly half an hour, depending on how many questions come through. And then in the second Facebook Live video, we'll have about a 5-minute break, and then we're going to be going through some of the exercises that Andrew does when he's in here, just as a bit of a demonstration. Fantastic to see that we're already getting engagement from the community, so thank you for already commenting. Just to go through those quickly, Julie says that she's just got home from Pilates, so perfect timing. So there you go, Julie. Feel free to comment and let us know about your thoughts in terms of Pilates, or if you have any questions or experiences you would like to share, send those through. And Jackie's actually just getting ready to go to Pilates. So there you go, Jackie. If you missed the online broadcast, you will be able to watch it back later. And Raylene thought I was the elite athlete. So thank you. Thank you, Raylene.
You did just run a half marathon.
I did just run a half marathon. Yeah, we don't need to talk about that. The check's in the mail, Raylene, for that comment. So I think one of the key things that comes up a lot, and I think you've both touched on it a little bit already, is that there is a sense from people, and this isn't just Pilates, this is exercise in general, people with MS, that it's going to be too difficult, that there's going to be limitations that are going to prevent them from doing that. From your perspective, Andrew, when you started out, was that something that you felt, thinking back 15 years ago?
It wasn't a situation the first time I went that I thought I would find it too difficult to do. When I first went, my conditions weren't bad. I moved fairly freely, much like an ordinary person. I was just a little bit tight and a little bit slow, would be the way I describe myself, and not particularly energetic would be the initial state. But when I first got there and first started to do it, it wasn't being taught by Sarah. I was asked to do very, very simple things, and I discovered that I couldn't do them. And it wasn't purely because of my MS. It was just because I was a bit of a slob, and I hadn't done things very well. I had been in a gym before I had an attack that put me into hospital, and I used to push weights around, and they were on machines, and that's what people traditionally think of as a gymnasium, but this is a gymnasium just as much as those more traditional ones that people are used to going to. But the form of exercise and the way you're trying to move is not designed as much to tighten you up and bulk you up and make you bigger and bulkier and more like Mr. Incredible out of the cartoon. It's designed to make you more flexible, more like a dancer, and more able to move with suppleness and freedom. And that's completely different. But when I first began, very, very simple things I found quite difficult, right down to the pattern of breathing. The whole pattern of breathing was actually preventing me from doing some of the exercises. So I had to retrain myself to think about when I'm moving, am I breathing in or am I breathing out? And now it's second nature and something you put in your normal life, and that's how you choose to move around. You're thinking about those things. But when I first began, I was doing everything wrong. I wasn't doing anything right. And it wasn't just because I had MS. It's because that's the way people are. And it made a huge difference just at that basic level. Over time, when I got my MS got more troublesome, I found that this was the thing that kept me going, because it gave me core strength, gave me the ability to think about moving properly and being aware of what I was supposed to do, as opposed to making lots of mistakes. And I think that's that whole pattern of movement that you gradually learn becomes very important in just keeping you mobile as you go along.
Yeah, fantastic. Just to let you know, another comment that's come through, your son wants to let you know that your dinner's ready.
My son's a very good cook, but
there you go.
It's going to be spoiled.
There you go. For anyone else who wants to comment, make sure you comment below. We'll be answering all the comments that come up, even if they're dinner related. And so I think one of the important points, and again you touched on this when you started talking, was that it's very much a tailored approach. It's not people come in and they're just necessarily chucked into a class and they have to do the same thing that everyone else is doing. That it's very much based on an individual's abilities. And that, I assume, and again, I'm not the expert here, so you guys are going to tell me this. One thing that we know a lot about MS is that day-to-day can be very different. So it's sort of being adaptable to how people are feeling on any given day. Is that...
Very much so. And just for those of you in the audience that may not know what a Pilates studio looks like or have this is new information to you. The type of Pilates we're talking about is in what Andrew sort of called a gym. It's a small, like we're a little gym, and our equipment looks a bit different to the gym equipment you'd see in a gym, as opposed to say going to a Pilates class at a gym where it might be on the mat with up to 20, 30 people in a room. That's not the Pilates we're talking about here. We're talking the Pilates, and if you're looking to get into Pilates, I'd recommend finding a studio that has all the equipment and runs small sessions that might be up to 4 people to 1 instructor. And it's almost personal training. The exercises can be tailored to you. If you're coming in and having a good day, the instructor can push you that little bit further with range of movement and with strength exercises. If it's not a good day, it can be pulled back and stripped right back to the basics to be focusing on the breathing, focusing on the flexibility, and have a much more gentle session, but still keeping the body moving. And I think that's the benefit that you get with what we call studio Pilates or semi-private Pilates, as opposed to a big mat class that isn't going to be able to be tailored to you individually. If your symptoms are, like you said, when you started, you still felt relatively normal, those mat classes, you know, may be appropriate and you can keep doing those. But if you are wanting a little more individual treatment, you feel that your body has its good days, its bad days, I'd be looking at the classes that utilize the equipment and have small groups, because then those changes in how the body is feeling, the good and bad days, limitations to you, kind of wash away because they can be managed.
And how important has that been for you, Andrew? Because, I mean, you and I have had a number of long chats. The first time I met Andrew, I think we talked for about four or five hours about a range of different topics. But you are definitely someone who I think I can confidently say knows yourself very well. Mm-hmm. And so you really have an idea of the things that you want to work on. So how important has it been for you to be able to come in here and talk to Sarah, especially about what you're dealing with?
That's absolutely critical. What you don't want to be is in a class where it's effectively aerobics lying down. We're in a large group class and it's all about feel the burn and come out of the other end of it covered in sweat. It's not about that at all. Quite often I don't sweat in a class. I'm moving quite gently. I'm grunting and groaning and making all kinds of noises because I'm not very happy with what I'm trying to do. But I'm never trying to get a cardio workout, which is what a lot of traditional group classes are all about. It's not about that at all. It's about getting the functional movement, getting the muscles moving in an order that makes sense. So a lot of people with MS, when they walk, they've got one leg that goes round and scribes a bit of a circle. Well, that's all about tightness through a whole chain of muscles that go all the way through the body. And I had that problem at one stage where one leg went forward and the other leg went round and then forward and then round. And that creates all kinds of other issues as you're going along. But now I walk like a normal person and I don't have that problem because I've isolated the muscles that I needed to work and made sure I was able to stretch them and work them and get the strength back into them. Because that's the issue with a lot of MS, where if anything to do with spasticity comes into it, is your muscles aren't strong, your muscles are weak. They're really, really weak. Mm-hmm. And the answer to that is to work out how to isolate them and get that muscle moving to gradually reintegrate it with the rest of the muscles that it belongs to get normal movement. There's no point in just doing a repetitious exercise like lifting a weight and putting it down, lifting it up and putting it down, because that's not going to achieve that at all. So those small classes make perfect sense, because Sarah can look at me and say, move your head to the left, or move your knees to the right, or stop rolling your hip very slightly, which you can't get in a big group class. You're only going to get that in a small class. And those tiny, tiny movements suddenly make the whole exercise more challenging, but a lot more sense than it was otherwise. So if you think you can do Pilates on your own, or you think you can hide in a very large group and go through the motions that a group instructor is going to going to be working through, you're not going to get it. You're going to have to go to see somebody who's going to look at you, and when they're looking at you, they're going to say, that's not quite right, in a very nice way, but that's not quite right, make this small adjustment, and suddenly you say, now I get it, now I feel it, now I know what I'm trying to do. It makes a huge difference.
And so I can sort of see that we've got a lot of new people who have just sort of come on and started watching. For people who have just come on and wondering what on earth we're talking about at the moment, I'm joined by Andrew and Sarah tonight at Pilates on Burke, and we're talking about how Pilates can be used to help manage your MS. As it's a Facebook Live video, if you do have questions as we're going along, we're answering any questions that come through. So all you need to do is just type them in the comments box underneath the video, and we'll be answering them as we go through. Questions that were submitted when we first talked about this event on our Facebook page, one of the big ones, and again, this is something that's just been touched upon a little bit, but worth talking about in a bit more detail. One of the big concerns that came through from a couple of people was, Pilates sounds great, but if I have to get down on the floor, it's going to take me a couple of days to be able to get back up again.
Yeah.
So floor exercises, do you do floor exercises with people MS? Do they have benefits, or do they have to form part of a sort of Pilates class that you do?
So we absolutely do floor exercises, but we wouldn't do them on the floor. So we're actually sitting on a piece of equipment here you can't see, but it's about bed height. So it's much easier to get up and down from, and you might even see behind us there are some pulleys and things like that. And there's a lot of things on the equipment that will assist you. So we will move from modifying those floor exercises if we think those floor exercises are applicable to the person, but we don't have to get onto the floor to do them. Mm-hmm. And that's the beauty of the equipment, is that a little bit of Pilates trivia. Mr. Pilates, that designed Pilates, it was back during the war. A lot of the equipment evolved from during the war injured soldiers being bedridden, not able to move, and then taking the springs from the beds and attaching them to the walls and making a sort of a pulley resistance system to get those injured people moving again. So it really does stem from rehabilitative needs for individuals that weren't able to move very freely at all. So absolutely you will get to learn floor exercises, but we don't need to get onto the floor to do them.
Okay.
Yeah.
So a question that's just come through from Raylene has said, how often, how many times should I go each week to gain the benefits? As I have MS, definitely have L plates on where exercise and MS are concerned. And my husband Wayne has AS and rheumatoid arthritis. Assume this would also benefit him.
Definitely. So I think both of you could actually go together. Depends how competitive you are in a class. I think in terms of how many times a week to do it, I would love all my clients to be able to do it at twice a week. I think you get fantastic benefit from. Andrew, I know, I think you started with twice a week, and maybe as time's gone on, you've increased it to three times a week.
At the very, very beginning,
fits in with your schedule.
Yeah, I started at once a week, thinking once a week was okay. And once a week doesn't work, because by the time you get through a week and get back there again, it's gone. So then I went to twice a week, and I found twice a week was quite useful. But it's 100% better to go three times a week than twice a week.
So I think in sort of a lot of exercise, or if you're trying to develop an art or improve at something, the more times you can do it, the more benefit you're going to get out of it. But being realistic with lifestyle, time, finances in today's world, I think twice a week is hugely beneficial, because the body can remember. From maybe you do it 2 days apart, the body can remember what it did those couple of days prior and start to build on that muscle memory. Whereas once a week, I think sometimes 7 days, if you're just starting to get into something, the brain can, there's a lot for the brain to learn and a lot for the body to learn when you're learning something new. So twice a week, and there may even be two or three exercises that you get your instructor to give you at home that can actually be done if you're watching the TV in the ad break. Just simple things that you can be doing on those off days at home to benefit what you're learning in the studio.
Thank you very much for that question, Riley. Hopefully that helps for anyone else who's watching. As I've said a couple of times, feel free to ask any questions that you want. Just drop them in the comment section and we will be answering them. Question that I have, how long do you need to do Pilates for before you start to notice a benefit? Is it the sort of thing where people might, well, one thing that we know, and this is true not just of exercise, but of other things, people sort of try it for a week or 2 weeks and go, well, this doesn't seem to be helping, so I'm going to stop. Is it something where you will notice a benefit in that very short term, or do you need to give it a bit of a chance before you will start to really notice a difference?
I would say it can vary amongst people, but I always say to my clients, be patient with it. It is something often, sometimes as well, likened to learning a foreign language. You have to start very basic and you feel like you learn some vocab and you forget it. I think Pilates can be the same. There's a lot to learn. It takes time, but it's once, if you put the effort in and are patient with learning the basics, then all of a sudden you start to notice it. I tend to say be patient, give it a number of weeks. There is a Pilates quote where in 10 sessions you'll feel a difference, 20 sessions you'll notice a difference, and I think in 30 sessions you'll have a whole new body. Now don't quote me on that, but I think it just shows that it does take a number of sessions before you will maybe really feel a longer term benefit from the sessions. And in the short term, you may feel worse because you're activating muscles mm-hmm. that you haven't been using for a little while, that don't want to activate, so they are being pushed, so you could actually feel a little worse before you feel better. Mm-hmm. And I just say persevere with that. I don't know if that's something you experience.
It's something like that. When I first started out, which is many, many years before I met Sarah, what stunned me about the first time I went is what I couldn't do. And there were very, very simple things that I remember doing when I was at school. And suddenly I wasn't able to do those things. They're just picking your leg up, putting it down a certain way, and you say, well, I can do that. And then you tried it and you thought, well, actually I can't do that, particularly when somebody's making me do it
in a particular way.
In a particular way, so it's absolutely correct. So I went out the door thinking, I can do better than this. I'll have to come back and have another go. So you don't approach it saying I'm going to feel a difference straight away. But one of the things they really focus on in Pilates is this sense of what they call spinal articulation, getting your whole vertebrae moving and freed up, because that's very important to just being able to do a lot of exercises, to have that freedom. So as you start going through this process of learning about that articulation so you can move freely, you suddenly find that one of the things that happens is you stand a little straighter and you feel a little taller. And they do sometimes say that Pilates makes you taller. So you can take it to more extreme levels. But I do remember after a couple of months of doing it, all the door handles dropped. So I'd reach out for the door handle and I was standing straighter, but I didn't notice it in the sense that something else had happened that I suddenly felt fantastic, but the door handles were an inch lower. And I reached in the wrong place for them, so I had to adjust. And I thought, well, it's making a difference, but it's not a difference that I can measure in a conventional sense. But it did make a difference. So I thought, I must keep doing this because I'm supposed to be standing upright. I'm not supposed to be stooped. And slowly that exposes other things that are wrong, and then you start to work on them. And it becomes a bit like doing an endless jigsaw. You can find a little piece and you put it into place, and all it does is produce a whole lot of other little pieces that you've then got to put into place, and it becomes very addictive. You really want to do it to get that further step. And then one day you do something and you say, that's extraordinary, I can't believe I did the thing that I just did. Mm-hmm. So you dash back to the office and say, I just did this exercise, and you try and explain it to everybody about what you've actually done, and they look at you with a glassy look on their face as though you're mad. But in fact, you've really achieved something, and that big step forward just helps you overall. It gives you a better sense of well-being, it helps you move better, and people see you as being more normal and not walking around with strange limps or unusual gestures. You're better for doing it, but you don't, it creeps up on you. You don't necessarily just notice it suddenly happening.
It creeps up on you, and then all of a sudden you've gone, oh, I never thought I would be able to do what you've just asked me to do, or you've maybe seen other people do it and gone, oh, I'll never do that. And then eventually you've been doing all these little things and boom, you've got somewhere where you probably didn't ever think you'd get to. And everyone is going to have different goals and different abilities, but yeah, I just feel like that kind of all washes away in here, and it's, I think, yeah, you really do achieve things in the body that you just thought were out of reach.
And is that still true now? I mean, you've worked with Andrew for 6 years. Are you still learning things
things that you've sometimes Sarah gets up and does something and I think, oh my God, it's like Cirque du Soleil. You know, how can anybody do this stuff and roll around? And some of these things I'm learning to do, and I get better and better as I go along, within the limitations that I have, but I get better as I'm doing it. But you rediscover this, a bit like you had when you were a kid at school, the joy of the playground, where you're actually on the monkey bars, and you're just mucking around on the monkey bars, and you're enjoying yourself. Mm-hmm. It's the same sensation. It's just something you've lost as you grow up, become an adult. Suddenly you become aware that it's actually, this is a lot of fun. This is not about grunting and sweating and staring in the mirror and wondering whether or not you're going to look like Superman. It's about having a lot of fun, and that's a very big part of it.
And a big part of it too is about, for people that are in pain, is having that pain-free, positive movement experience that the body reacts to and actually releases some good endorphins. So it's not only is it a physical thing, by getting into movement, the brain responds and is happier. So I think it affects both the body and the mind in a positive way.
And certainly, I mean, one thing that we know that people comment a lot with having multiple sclerosis is that feeling of isolation. Now, having met the two of you a couple of times, one thing that seems to be really apparent is that you have quite a good connection when you work here. You get along really well. And I mean, you're probably the best person to talk to about it. Coming in here and doing the Pilates is obviously great and helps you a lot. But also having someone to come in and talk to and have that sort of interaction with, I assume that's part of the enjoyment factor that you get as well. Sarah's not listening, you can say it, but
That is part of it. And it's not just Sarah, it's also the other people in the class. Like, you end up talking, you're chatting. It's not as though you're all lined up on the running machine, just going through the treadmill, and you've got the headphones on. And
although
you're not,
there might be some stricter studios than ours out
there.
We allow a little chit-chat.
Yeah. But that becomes
class.
Part of it, because there's nothing, I think, more beneficial than you see somebody else do something that you didn't think they could do for the first time, and you say, that's really good. And it creates this rapport. And it goes backwards and forwards, where people are talking to each other because you're sharing a common experience. But you're absolutely right about MS is unbelievably isolating, because it's almost impossible to explain to somebody who doesn't have it exactly how you feel and exactly what you're going through. So there's a tendency for people to think, my MS is different to everybody else's MS. Well, it's not that different. There's a lot of similarities. I can spot somebody with MS down the street. I know where they are. I understand what they're going through. I don't have a relationship with them, but I can spot what's going on. And I often think to myself, gee, it'd be good if you were doing a bit of Pilates, because that would help you. Because it does help destroy that sense of isolation. It does reconnect you to yourself as much as to anybody else. And you've got to have a good feeling about yourself before you can have a good feeling about anybody else. And the Pilates does help a lot with that.
And I think at a studio, it does become a nice community, and clients do get to know each other. And there's nice chit-chat in the studio amongst clients. So it's a really welcoming place to be. And everyone is carrying ailments.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone that is in the studio is carrying something that is bothering them. physically, mentally, work-wise, or, you know, but they're here to for a reason and to improve, and that's just a really nice, nurturing place to be.
As another point, just we will be finishing up the Q&A part of this shortly, so if anyone who is watching does have a question that they want to ask or a comment, please put that now so that we can answer it while we're doing this part before we shift to the demonstration side of the night. Talking about the mental aspect, Andrew, when we did the video with you a while back, and for anyone who hasn't seen it, go onto our YouTube channel and look for that video with these guys. One of the things you talked about, the mental aspect, was being in here, you really have to just focus on what you're doing, and it allows you to zone out from all of the other thoughts that are rushing through your head at every other moment of the day. Do you want to just talk about that again? Because I found that really interesting at the time.
It is absolutely true, because the problem you have when you're not feeling very well for whatever reason, or even at work, if you're being stressed out by the people around you, you're carrying all this burden, all this tension in your whole body, and you need to release that in some way. And if you come to a Pilates studio, and I've sometimes come in when I was working, I'd come in steaming about the day that I was having, and I'd be very
horrible.
Cross. So Sarah would sometimes look at me and turn around and go, get on that roller and stay there. And you'd have to learn to relax and chill and settle down a little bit. And then you're given something to do. It mightn't appear to be a difficult thing to do, but the more you do it, and then she says, that's not quite right. You've got to make this slight adjustment. And you make the slight adjustment, say, well, I should be able to do this. And the next thing, you've completely lost the connection with the things that were stressing you out or the things that were making you uncomfortable, and you're just focusing in on the one thing that you want to do and you want to do correctly. And when you get that right, there's a sense of achievement, and then you're ready to do something else that's correct, as opposed to saying, well, now I've got that right, I've got to go back to that thing that was really annoying me. You're saying, I'm ready for the next thing that I can do well.
It's almost mindfulness.
It is.
Exercise facilitated way.
It is, and you just have to let go. And of course, you can't do these exercises if you get yourself all wound up, because you try and do it, you're too tense, you can't relax, your head's in the wrong place, you can't get there, and that's where you need an individual instructor to turn around and say, you need to do the following exercise, and you need to do it in this pattern, this way, so just get on with it. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you're in a big group class, they'll never see you doing that, and you'll just make a mess of it, and you won't make a good job of building all the strength and the supplements that you need to do. You need to be in these small classes to do it.
Mm-hmm. If you could set up a little Pilates gymnasium at the MCG, because I feel like I might need one at halftime at most Carlton games if I need to get out of those sort of...
What about if Carlton's playing Richmond?
Yeah, no, we're not going to talk about that. We've already had comments on Reddit. It's already coming through, don't worry. A couple of questions that have just come through. Glenda's just asked, is reformer work good for MS clients?
Absolutely. So reformer, and we'll get to show you what a reformer is in a minute. It is basically a bed that moves back and forth with a lot of pulleys coming off it. It's what we call closed chain exercise a lot of the time. So the machine gives you a lot of feedback. So if... I will show a few different ways, but it can be used to really strengthen the leg muscles. It can be used to strengthen the arm muscles. If balance and standing and walking is a challenge, the reformer is great, because you can train the legs to work while the back is supported. You can train the abdominals. So if as well, if you are, you know, have progressed to a stage where you are using a walking frame, a walking stick or walking chair, we absolutely get you out of that and onto the reformer, and we can get you moving. It's a really supportive piece of equipment. It looks somewhat scary, but we'll show you a few things that we can do on that in the second part.
Well, that's just another question that's just come through from Alison. And if you missed the start, Alison, don't worry, the whole video stays up on the Facebook page, so you can go back and watch the whole thing. She's just asked whether Pilates is suitable for someone who walks with a frame.
So absolutely. So I've just mentioned the reformer. there's some other equipment we'll show you, which is called a Wonder Chair. Some people think it's not so wonderful. But that is a great tool to teach balance and proprioception, because there are lots of handles you can hold on to that almost can mimic your frame, but teach you to then take the hands off and balance. So there's some really useful pieces of equipment. So having a frame is not a limitation at all. We might even use your frame for some exercises for you to do at home.
Okay, and another question that's come in.
We are there.
All right, I'll jump in. All right, welcome back, everyone. Apologies for those technical difficulties. We're going to move to part two of the Facebook Live video now anyway, which is going to be demonstrating some of the common Pilates exercises. But before we do that, we had one last question from the Q&A session in part one, which was about whether people could expect to have the same sort of experience regardless of the studio they went to, or whether it was going to depend on the sort of beliefs of the instructor.
And that's a really good question. And I'll say every instructor will inject their own personality into teaching. But if you're looking for a authentic Pilates studio with fully qualified instructors working in a studio Pilates environment with this equipment around you, the ethos will be very similar. I would hope it's very similar. I think as a Pilates instructor or anyone working in allied health, we all have a particularly, I think, giving and hopefully nurturing, caring nature, and really have a strong passion for what we do. I think what's most important when you're looking for a studio is to find an instructor at that studio that you could feel comfortable with to be yourself, to be vulnerable, and if you don't find that you have the right fit with one instructor, don't be afraid to try another. We all recognize that we're all different, and I think that the biggest thing is feeling comfortable with the person that's teaching you, feeling like you're walking into a safe environment. So if you are studio shopping around, go into the studio if you can, or call them up on the phone. Get a feel for the person that you're going to be working with, because I think if you can get a good feel from them in at a conversation level or just a first meeting face to face, I think you'll have a really good experience.
Okay. Yeah. All right, I'm going to get off camera. No one wants
okay.
to see me anymore, so I'm going to leave you guys to it.
On that aspect that Sarah's just gone through, the other thing I think to defend the Pilates instructors is that you come along for the 1 hour or so that you're there, but they've done hour after hour after hour of people, and every one of them's going to come in and the same question's going to get asked is, how are you? And they're always going to say, I'm miserable, I'm sore, I'm tight, there's something wrong with me. They're going to hammer every single one of those instructors with the same series of problems, and that instructor's then got to absorb them, fix them up, send them off, and the next person comes in and says exactly the same thing. When you do come in, say, I've come here with a plan in mind, I have MS, I want to make my MS symptoms more tolerable, and I'm willing to do the work, and I'm willing to do what I need to do to improve myself. If you do that, you're going to get the most unbelievable response from that Pilates instructor, as opposed to saying something that's always negative. So you've got to change your own mindset from saying it's all about me to saying we're going to work like a team. What have I got to do to make this work, and you're going to show me what to do? So I think you have to act like you're part of a team, not exclusively expect to be waited on hand and foot.
And being part of a team, you're going to get down on the reformer.
Yeah, and you do what you're told.
And you do what you're told.